Right, Aki Karim here for BBTV. I'm delighted to be joined this morning by Richard Harris. Now, last time, Rich, I gave you an introduction, but perhaps you want to do your own introduction this time.
Okay, well, I'm a life coach and I help people become the best version of themselves, including boxers and professional athletes. And should I do more than that, or is that
That,
enough?
no, that's great for now because that's perfectly leads on to what we're going to talk about today. And it's a really serious topic that me and you have very similar opinions on. It's very close to our hearts. It's very important to us, and it is depression. We're going to talk about it as a wider context, but you know, obviously, we want to try and focus this towards helping boxers who maybe they've retired and they're finding it hard to fill that void of boxing. Maybe they've come off a loss, which they're finding hard to take. Maybe they're just struggling to deal with society, or maybe it's wider than that, and they're suffering with something in their lives which is affecting their own boxing career.
Well, some people would be like, they'll be doing well and on the surface they'll be looking fine, but underneath that facade, like, they're fucking suffering every single day, even though they're just about able to hold it together. There'll be a lot of people listening to this would be just like that.
Maybe let's just delve into this then. Let me just change this so it's on you and you can give us all your pearls of wisdom. So depression, Rich. I mean, you must have clients that come to you as a life coach that are suffering, whether they know it or they don't know it, with depression. How do you define depression?
Okay, so yeah, it would be like a top five challenge, I think, in like life coaching and probably most therapies. I would say, okay, how do you define it? The answer that pops into mind is like the Western psychology, like, kind of DSM definition, where it's like things like negative affect, low mood, like low libido, just a dampened sense of mood, a dampened sense of affect, and like a sense that life is somehow unbearable. And then you future cast that out and you look at like the next 30, 40, 50 years of life. You're like, nope, nothing good could possibly ever come out of that ever. So there's like a nihilistic feeling of doom that often comes with it. I think they're most of the points from the DSM, but it's that type of thing.
Do you get quite a lot of clients that come to you with these symptoms then, and they need help with this?
Yeah, like, so I don't know whether it's like, because it's my practice, which is different, or it's representative, not, but like, I find anxiety is more common, but for sure depression is mega common, and I see it a lot when I'm out and about and I talk to people. I see a lot of people that are kind of badly hiding depression, you know.
You mentioned anxiety there, Rich. What's the difference actually? That's something I want to know personally. What's the difference between anxiety and depression?
So anxiety is, so depression is how I described it there, but like, anxiety is like this pervasive feeling of like background fear. Like, there's this alarm of fear that's just going on and on and on. Like, you think about the future and it doesn't just seem dark, it seems terrifying. Like, something very bad, your worst nightmares are about to happen, you know? So I think that could be the way that you describe anxiety, like a fear, a constant level of fearfulness. Yeah.
So you get a client that comes to you and you've got to quickly assess, I suppose, what symptoms they've got. Let's just say they're self-aware that they have depression. So is the initial consultation like? What is the initial process you need to find to be able to help somebody with depression?
Yeah, well, so what you do is you talk. So you, and then really quickly, like, I think almost every single coaching client I've ever had, like, the thing that's the problem comes out really quickly. Maybe they're not achieving enough. Maybe they're full of anxiety. Maybe they're in a shit relationship or whatever it is. Really quickly, that comes out. I think I said in the last interview, in a lot of cases, they actually know what the problem is. And then you start diving into it. So yeah, does that answer your question? Because that's.
No, it does. It does. It does. So actually, that's actually something that people are saying to you. I think I have this. I think I have this. And then there are cases though, and this is you get this in boxing a lot, Rich, because it's a such a masculine environment, hyper masculine, hyper violent environment in some senses and contexts, where people you can see there's something wrong, but they're not going to say I've got depression. They're not going to say that. How do you go about that?
Yeah, well, that's like, so we men have many strengths and we should be celebrated for those strengths, and quite frankly in our modern culture we're not. But one of our weaknesses is like we're just not very good at that. Like, you know, it's we don't just open up and talk about that if we're feeling depressed, because, like, you know, we tend to bottle it up, and that's not all. Sometimes that's the best thing. Bottling up and getting on with it will deliver, Oftentimes it doesn't. Sorry, what was the original? Did that answer the question?
Yeah. So I'm just trying to say, like, obviously, if people aren't forthcoming with that information, is it hard to spot? Do you have a much, much harder task as a life coach to sort of get them, to help them?
No, but that's only because I've done this for a long time, and like if you spend a long time doing it, you get really good at it. But like I think it can be hard, like if you don't just have all that training. Like is it hard to go into the ring and do four rounds of sparring for a professional boxer? No, you do it all the time, but to an average person, it's going to be very difficult, right? But I would say though, because like the aim is to help some people that suffer from depression here, like. Probably in most cases, like if you're listening to this and you think, oh shit, I do have a bit of depression. If you just speak to someone that you've got a good relationship with and say, look, what's my problem? Like, you know, do you think I'm depressed? Or just open up about it and ask them to help you out. I'm pretty sure you'd be able to get some good stuff from that.
Yeah. Well, we do. We want to focus on helping. I see a lot of this, and it's, you know, I was a teacher for 12 years. See a lot of it there. More increasing, you know, in the younger space, but also in boxers, in particular retired boxers who find it difficult to adjust to life after boxing from the highs, and then they've got nothing afterwards. I speak to a lot of boxers about this. Can you provide, I mean, I know we're just, it's not supposed to be something you just do dead quickly, but we are trying to do these bite-sized chats for people. Is there something that, a basic starting point where people can go about to try and start getting themselves out of this? And what tips would you advise?
Yeah, 1,000,000%. I mean, I think for most personal development, it's the intersection between the general practices that generally work and then the sort of custom stuff that's unique to the individual. Like, I mean, boxing's the same. Like there's a way to do a jab, there's a way to do a cross, there's a way to do all the other stuff, right? But then you make it your own, right? And I think coaching is no different. So absolutely, we can talk about the general stuff. Okay, so if you've cut, for that example, when you've come off a career and like, you know, you've been doing that for like 10, 15, 20 years or whatever, and then now you feel depressed, instantly what comes to mind is like a lack of meaning. So this is one of the big things with tackling depression. It's not so much about having the means about you or having the infrastructure and stuff like that. Often that's not so important. It's about having enough meaning behind you. And actually, I think like most people that are really happy are like that Greek myth Sisyphus, when the guy's like pushing the boulder up the hill. You know that myth?
Yeah. Okay. I do. So perhaps some of the viewers won't know the myth.
Okay. So there's a Greek myth. Maybe you'll be able to put extra context on this than I'm able to. But like, there's this guy that like I think he like tricks the gods. And they get really pissed off of him. So they doom this guy Sisyphus to continually push this massive boulder up a hill. And just before it gets to the top, it comes rolling back down again. But the idea is that like that's our lives. And actually, when you do that, and the boulder is a worthwhile boulder that's worth moving, it becomes like pleasurable, you know? So I've heard elsewhere that like happiness is the progressive realization of a worthy ideal, which is just another way of reframing the Sisyphus myth. Put into the framework of your question about like a boxer that's come off a career, like you're not going to have meaning. What you would have got a major amount of meaning for, like going for a world title or whatever it was, is now gone. So you must find that meaning. You must find a boulder that is worthwhile moving to go push up the hill every day. And that could be a charity. It could be being a great father. It could be like some hobby that you love. It could be some political work, anything. It could be anything at all. What I would say though, is make sure it's aligned to your deep, authentic sense of self, which there's a little bit of nuance of how to find that. Our society finds it difficult on the whole, but if it's something where your energy naturally flows to, and if you're able to say, yeah, that really is me. That's not who I want to appear as or who I want to appease people with. This is the real me. If you're struggling hard on something that really feels like the real you, then you will have meaning. And I think that if you understand that one insight, and I can go deeper on it if you want me to clarify it, but if you understand that one insight, that should nuke a ton of depressive cases out there.
Yeah. And going back to that element of Greek mythology there, the boulder, even though it's a small menial task, rolling a boulder, it becomes part of purpose. And I think that actually linked back to what Stephen Hawking said quite a few times. He said one of the most important thing to have is have a purpose of work or some purpose, basically, which gives you that drive, because that's essential. Without that, everything falls apart. So Having a sense of purpose, it doesn't have to be something big, does it, Rich? It doesn't have to be something big, as you mentioned. It can be something small, because people might be thinking, oh yeah, but I don't want to go out and do it. I haven't got the skills to go out and get that job, or I haven't got loads of money to do that. You don't have to actually have a lot of money to fill your life with purpose, do you?
No. It's just got to be real and authentic. But that's the challenge because, like, you know, our culture is brilliant in a lot of ways, but one of the criticisms of this culture is we've lost our hearts. Our intellects have got preposterously strong, and we've lost our hearts. So like we don't know what's authentic, and we don't know what's real because the whole freaking thing out there is so plastic, and we've become so plastic adapting to this profoundly sick society. So it's a really check. We can make nuclear reactors and send spaceships and stuff to the moon and combustion engines and all this cool stuff and live stream across the internet, but we can't answer simple spiritual questions like what's your passion, what's authentic, what's real. That's a real challenge for most people in our culture. And to your point, like if you it doesn't have to be big, it doesn't have to be small, it doesn't have to be anything. It just has to be authentic, and it has to be a worthwhile struggle for you. And then happiness will follow from that meaning that you generate.
Okay, well, that's a great tip. That's a great tip. So fill your life with some purpose, or genuine, authentic purpose. Where can we go next? Where can we go next? Is there anything else that's going to help people in the? I really want to focus on trying to help people who are watching this video, and they are depressed right now, or you feel they are depressed right now. What else could they do? What other things would you suggest?
Well, like with most of these problems, right? You want to look at all the different domains. So you want to look at like the different parts of the bodily stuff, and then the sort of surface level psychological, which we did there. It's like, look, the way you orient your mind and that kind of, the surface level of your mind, make that towards meaning. And also, you want to get things for the deeper spiritual level. So let's talk about the body because that's easy to understand. So if I was coaching someone and they were depressed, I'd be like, right, let's look at basics. What's your sleep like? So there's fucking so many coaching clients, especially people that like, run, big high pressure businesses and stuff like that. Like, how many hours of sleep did you get last night? Like 4.5. And I went to bed at like 1 in the morning, and I turned my laptop off at like 12:30. It's so common. And I'm like, oh yeah, you're depressed, are you? Like, yeah. I think I see a connection here, Like I don't know what you think, Aki, but like when we were growing up, there was this idea of like, you sleep is for weaklings, and you got to get like 3 hours sleep, and you hustle. And I think that's such a retarded idea. But what do you think?
Yeah, well, I'm in the industry where you don't get that much sleep, especially if you're out on a show at a weekend or something. And yeah, there is definitely a link between the quality of sleep you get and how you feel the next day. I think there is. I think there is. I've seen it, and sometimes you wake up and you've had a good night's sleep, and you say, "Oh, I feel really good. I've had a really good night's sleep." And yeah, so I think that whole idea about and I know what you're saying there. It was drilled into me like, oh yeah, forget about sleep. Like you be more productive, be more productive.
So
But
dumb, man. So
yeah.
dumb. And like, isn't your best work done? Like, if you had like one, even one, but let's just say like a few nights of really good sleep, like, and you had like a really important like bit of commentary to do or something like that, you'd be at your most charming and your most entertaining and passionate, right? When you had that sleep in place.
Yeah, I mean, that's been my experience, certainly. Yeah.
Yeah, and it's going to be true for all athletes as well. So like, this one study I read ages ago comes to mind where they studied like American college athletes. And like, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think in the American college scene, it's quite, if you do well in that, you kind of like set up for a career in the sport. Isn't that the case?
I think so. They have the sports scholarships, and it's big. Like they have all the little things called Little League or something. Anyway. All the sports they have at university are attended by thousands of people. It's big.
I saw that when I did an exchange in Idaho, like Idaho State University, and I remember just seeing the football, the American football stadium was like, it was like as big as like the Ipswich football ground, in Ipswich, and like the basketballers, they were like professional athletes. It was mental. So anyway, they did this study on like sports scholarship athletes in American universities. And they just said, look, whatever your level, they did a control condition where they didn't change anything. And then they did one, they said, right, with whatever your sleep level is, add 1 hour or add 2 hours or what have you. And basically what they found is no matter how much sleep they were getting, if they had more sleep, they performed better in their chosen craft, whether it's basketball, American football, anything. So that's, I mean, I know we're talking about depression. We'll get back to that in a second. But like, if you're a boxer and you're listening to this and you want to be better in your craft, freaking get the sleep. Some of the professional athletes I know sleep a lot. Like that tennis guy, like Nadal, doesn't he sleep like freaking 12 hours a day or something? Like,
I don't know, to be honest, because boxing's taken over my life. But I know that boxers are, when they're in a camp, they are told, a lot of them are told to get to bed by 9 o'clock. They are told that. But yeah. One of the problems you got now is, especially with young boxers, is to spend bloody the late night hours on the freaking phones, looking at all the stuff and tweeting and retweeting and all that nonsense.
Right. Okay, let's get into the weeds. So on the question of sleep, right? So here's the things that impede that. We mentioned switching the laptop off for your business just before bed, right? You're going to get shit disturbed sleep from that, probably nightmares and stuff. The phone is one of the key things that's come up again and again and again with the coaching, especially the stuff that you're looking at on the phone. I mean, forget the EMF radiation that's there, by the way, that having that stuff close to you is dangerous anyway, but you're looking at this anxiety producing social media stuff all the time, or like soft porn on Instagram, or like actual proper porn. You see some nice ass on Instagram, you're like, fuck it, I'll look at some proper porn. And that's no good. Like all that stuff is going to give you crap sleep and put you in a bad mood. So get off the laptop, get off the phone. And the other thing is keep a fixed schedule. So like, if you want really good circadian rhythms, which is the fancy way of saying your sleep cycle rhythm stuff, like have a fixed bedtime and a fixed wake up time. And if you want a recommendation of how many hours to do it, if you're a professional athlete, probably go more than this, but I'd say like nine, aim for 9 hours. That's what I aim for. And then take a nap as well. And if you look at the studies done on the hormones and stuff, your growth hormone, your testosterone, your cortisol levels, they're all going to be in more favorable levels, and that those are all connected in different ways to performance. So it's like going on a small amount of steroids, just by having good sleep. And of course, you can't get done in by the anti-doping people just for getting good sleep. I would also say, if you want to go down that route, like if you stack that with a bunch of supplements that, like, so not only did you have the good sleep, but you had all the really good supplements that geared up for that, like, you know, that would be hormonally very powerful. So,
well, and actually you don't have to spend any money on getting good sleep. Rich, you mentioned supplements, and you've mentioned this to me before in the past. And I think, why not? Why don't we go down that road? If people, I know you've mentioned their supplements to help the sleep, and this is of course linked into helping people who are suffering from depression, because good sleep can help you if you're in a depressed state.
So,
what supplements would you recommend?
Oh man, well, there's a long answer to that. On the topic of depression, right? If you look at the basics, like pretty much all of us are like kind of going to be vitamin or mineral or micronutrient deprived somehow, and so like taking supplements is about like getting these deficiencies that basically all of us have away. So, I mean, I've got a long list. Like, I'll tell you what, if anyone emails me, like, if you go to my web, there you go, this is a good marketing thing. If you go to my website, go to the contact box. I'm being serious also. Just say, Rich, yeah, I heard you're
interviewed. Give us your website link verbally, Rich, and I'll put it in the below as well.
Okay, so it's richardharriscoaching.com. Go to the contact box and just say, Rich, I heard about supplements. Can you send me your current handout? I've got this handout that I give to clients, and I spent freaking ages going through and finding out the right ones and finding the best places to buy it. I'll just send it to you. And the cool thing is, like, because the way I do my practice is like I research the stuff and I practice on myself, and then I give people the experiment that works. So this is like 20 years of playing around with supplements and that kind of thing. So but it's stuff like magnesium, iodine, like zinc. There's loads that you need.
What about vitamin D, Rich? Because a lot of people who I've spoke to about depression in the past have said, or this is doctors actually who have said this. They've said vitamin D is crucial to avoiding depression. Basically, that's what they said. Obviously these are, what do you think on it? Basically, is what I'm trying to say.
I agree with the doctors on this strongly. Yeah, the evidence is pretty conclusive on that. And also, like, there's evidence to suggest that some people suffering from sleep can nuke that with vitamin D. I know one client, we were going back and forth with all these different interventions for months. We got it sometimes and didn't get it sometimes. He got his blood levels of vitamin D right up, and it solved the sleep problem. So for that people, that'll be the magic bullet.
Yeah, people often talk about exercise as well, and we've talked about this in the past. We've high-profile figures like Tyson Fury come out there and he attributes his battle with depression and winning the battle to exercising regularly. Can you go into more detail for us as to why people should do that? Because easier said than done. When boxers retire, they've been training their entire lives. It's not something they want to go back into straight away. So let's just say we've got the average person who's not a professional athlete, or they've had a few years away from boxing. They're not as fit as they used to be. What can they do to get that sort of same kick from exercise?
Yeah. So, I mean, basically train regularly. I think if you really, really want to be on it, like train every day, but a mixture of cardio, strength and mobility, but your aim will be different. So if you're a professional boxer, obviously your aim is to go in and do that fight and win. This is different. This is like holistic wellness. So you want to like spend a lot of time on things like yoga. You want to like go for a run, and it doesn't even have to be that long. Like 20 minutes, I find, is like a massive mood booster. By the way, if you're depressed and you're listening to this and you're like, yeah, I still feel fucking shit after this interview, like go for a run, go for a 20 minute run. Like I say that to my clients when they're having a really bad time. Like basically always your mood will improve a little bit from a run. And then do a bit of weights and strength stuff. And so your aim isn't to be like a finely tuned athletic machine. The goal is to like just be really holistically healthy, like have low body fat, like good toned muscle, lots of flexibility, and just be all around healthy. And that will certainly permeate into your mental health.
Yeah. I feel like we're cooking on gas here. We've got a few good tips. We've got, you know, the supplement stuff, which hopefully you're going to help with as well. If people email you, you've got the sleep, you've got the exercise. Is there something else? I want to try and get to maybe five tips that people can go away with. We've got three there.
We have five? Meaning as well. So in the psychological.
Yes, purpose, of course. Yeah, we've got purpose. Having that purpose, having something, whether it be a daily chore or a routine, something like that. I mean, some of the happiest people, the very happiest person I know, and she's always happy. She's a good friend of mine. She works in a coffee shop and she basically loves it. And she's not making loads and loads of money, but she absolutely loves it. She loves talking to people and it gives her that purpose, and she's the happiest person I know.
Okay. So, there's three more insights we'll do. Social. So if you can seek out loving relationships with family, friends, charitable people, business people, anything you like, and then have meaningful conversations with other loving people. So that's something that will improve your lifespan. They found that health span, not life. Yeah, both lifespan and health span. So they found that like communities of centenarians, that is people that live more than 100 years, they're always in places where there's like loads of this community stuff going on. So it makes you healthy longer, it makes you live longer, and it makes you happier. So seek out those relationships. And we're suffering a lot in our modern culture at this time, and that's one of the difficult things to do. So if you can have that, that'll be a massive asset. So that tackles the problem on the social domain. One more on the biological domain, look at your nutrition. So if you're eating like crap food, like just crap, cheap, like corner shop food, like just it's fast food, McDonald's, that kind of thing, like that is a recipe for mental disorder, including depression. So, ladder out of that and then ladder into a healthy diet. The diet I use, and I think the one that probably will work for most people out there, is the cyclic ketogenic diet. The science on that is freaking excellent. I recommend going to if this is new to you, recommend a resource like Dr. Berg, like Eric Berg. He's on Odyssey. He's also on YouTube. Really healthy guy. And learning from someone like him how to do a ketogenic or a cyclic ketogenic diet would be a really good idea. And if that's a bit extreme, maybe go to paleo or something, which is like, I'm not going to get into it too much, but it's sort of like keto light. And that's another option you might look into. So that's the food. So we got like, we got the social, we got the food.
Yeah.
The last thing I'd say is like, look at a spiritual practice. So we're in a materialist culture, and I know like people don't want to hear about spirituality. And I think a lot of that is understandable because spirituality got really degenerated. It got about like, oh yeah, I'm a Christian, I'm a Catholic, and all these wars happened, it just became meaningless and empty. Like nothing really happened. What I would say is like, if you get into the spirituality properly, it should be a very visceral working experience, rather like a martial art. You don't go to a boxing session and come back and think, did something happen? Did I learn how to fight there? You did. You got your head bashed in a bit. You got some good shots in if you were lucky. Like you worked hard, your cardio's worked, you know something happened. And what I would say is find a spiritual practice that's like that, where you go in to the deeper parts of your psyche, that it's beyond the mere psychological and into the spiritual domains of your psyche, and find a practice that works to you, that speaks to you, that's authentic to you, where you can work with that, that will be an extremely powerful solution to depression if you're able to do that. But like I say, like, we're an extremely extroverted culture. We're, you know, we can build nuclear reactors and aircraft and that kind of thing, but we've lost our connection to that sort of stuff. So that's a harder thing for people in our culture to do. But the information is out there, and if you're able to not even crack it, but just get like a little bit of that spiritual well, then you will get a lot. Well, that's where all the happiness and success really lies, if you really master that stuff.
That's brilliant. And you know what? Each of those things you just mentioned there, I think we could even do separate or more a more in-depth, because obviously this is just like something that we wanted to do to sort of help people in a short-term type of fix if they can. But each of those things, we could really go into so much more detail, couldn't we? And you think we
so
could?
Much.
I think we should at some point do that. Do you not think?
Yeah, mate, I'm happy to do it. One more, just to help people fast. If you're in a really bad state, depression, anxiety, anything, you're like, oh, crap, what do I do? I need to reset it. Like, go do a fast. You know, if it's your first one, just do 24 hours or 36 hours. If you've done it a few more times, like maybe aim for 3 or 4 days. You will come off that fast a lot healthier and a lot happier, and certainly in a lot better space spiritually. So that's another tool that I'd give people that are suffering from depression.
Maybe then, Rich, then, because I really, you said something, an interesting one to me last time, and you said it again today, which is about surrounding yourself with good people. You mentioned community and the people the centenarians, I think you said, people who live over 100.
Yeah. Yeah.
I think that's a really important one, how to surround yourself with people that, you know, people that are not toxic. I think that's I think that's worth doing an entire chat about.
Well, we talk a lot about this, like just as mates, right? But it's so slippery and so subtle. And like to understand the difference between a toxic relationship and a good relationship, for most of us, is very confusing. So yeah, I'd love to talk about that. Absolutely.
Yeah. The other one that, Rich, that I think we really should touch on as well in more detail is the fasting. Because I know it's something that you brought into my life, and it really, really helped me genuinely with a number of things. And I'm not an expert in it at all, but I think that knowledge passed on to people, which is what we want to do, is try and help people. That would be fantastic.
Yeah, fasting is off the charts powerful in spiritually, biologically, socially, psychologically, anything. It's ridiculous how powerful it is. So I would love to get that message out, and I'd certainly love to help people with that. Yeah.
Guys, in the meantime, if you want to get in touch with Rich and maybe talk to, I mean, I don't know about the particular services that you offer, because we just talk as friends, but if you want to get in touch with Rich to maybe ask him about working with him or him life coaching you, etc., what's the best way for them to do that?
Yeah, the best way to find me is to go on my website, richardharriscoaching.com, go to the contact thing, and I've got a contact box, fill that out. I help people like professional athletes, like sort of CEO type people, like a lot of high performance people. You don't have to be like that, but that's just the type of person that typically comes to the practice these days. If you want free stuff, like go on my Odyssey channel. And so I'm easy to find on Odyssey. Just type in like Richard Harris Coaching. And I do a live stream twice a week, and I do other personal development videos. So those are the two ways to find me.
That is fantastic. And I know it's only, again, a bite-sized chunk, but I think we agreed that doing bite-sized chunks helps with certain topics. But we're going to touch wood plan with your next visit. I know you're in Cheshire a bit more now.
Yeah.
We're going to plan for you. We're starting a new podcast, and we really want you on the podcast. Really want you on the podcast. And then there's no time limit. And we can literally just bust it out for hours and talk about all these things.
We'll get deeper into it, and we'll get more into the weeds. It'll be really nice. Yeah, it'll be fun.
Fantastic. Rich, thanks there for giving us a few tips and giving people a few tips out there. I think depression is such a sad thing, man. It's such a sad thing. And anything, even if someone can pick up a little tiny bit that could just help them, even just getting through the day, that's important.
No. Look, I'll stand on this statement, bold as it is. If you give me 100 depressed people and they do like most or all of the things I said here, find meaning, get your sleep sorted, sort your nutrition out, train hard, like look at the spiritual practices, all that stuff, fast. Yeah, I don't know what the number is, but a gigantic portion of those 100 people will no longer be depressed. And if you're just merely in a bad mood and you do all that stuff, the same is the case. It's also the case that if you're in a good mood and you want to be in a really good mood, this stuff works great for that too. So I know it's a whistle stop tour, but like these things are freaking powerful. So get to them, audience members. It works.
Rich, thanks as always, mate, and I'm looking forward to the next chat already.
Thank you, Aki. Cheers.